Prince of Persia's place in gaming is a little odd. In the past, it was one of the most influential PC games of all time. A focused singular vision from its sole developer, Jordan Mechner, and a groundbreaking trilogy from Ubisoft that followed. In the modern age, however, it's mostly forgotten. After a line of near-constant reboots, it's been a rarity to hear anything from the franchise at all, especially on a AAA scale. This is the story of how that came to be, how its biggest successor, Assassin's Creed, was able to capture the hearts and wallets of gamers just as the Prince's light was fading, and how a tech demo for a next-gen Prince of Persia game accidentally created Ubisoft's biggest franchise. This is Prince of Persia: Assassins. By all metrics that mattered, Prince of Persia: The Sands of Time was a success. But upon its release, creative director Patrice Désilets was having trouble with the idea of a sequel. Creating another story starring the titular unnamed prince seemed a little samey. There was only so much you could do with a character who was just waiting to be king. Instead of a straightforward sequel, however, Ubisoft would move Désilets, lead producer Jade Raymond, and a team of about 20 Sands of Time developers into work on a next-generation Prince of Persia title, with a new engine and a targeted release around 2007. When taking some vacation post-Sands of Time at the end of 2003, Désilets would encounter a book on secret societies that featured a chapter on the Muslim Order of Assassins that had existed in 12th century Persia, Iraq, and Syria. This organization, founded by Muslim missionary Hassani Sabah, had been the influence for countless stories, as far back as Marco Polo's romanticized travelogues through the region, all the way up to Dan Brown's 2000 novel Angels and Demons, whose sequel, The Da Vinci Code, had received a film adaptation the same year Désilets and team released Sands of Time. Their intention was to shift the focus away from the prince, turning him into a character to be saved and protected by the Order of Assassins, while also potentially in a similar role as Pharah in the first Ubisoft game, by assisting the player with his special powers. Based on some of the concept art and in the spirit of the role reversal of the prince's rescue, it's been speculated that the game at this time was to feature a female protagonist, while also kicking around the idea of a co-op campaign with multiple playable assassins. That concept art of the project also shows a new visual style that was grounded in the post-Gladiator sword and sandals revival the film industry had been seeing around that time, and not the 1001 Arabian Nights feel of the original. Core pieces of the series it would become are already here, including hooded figures and the hidden blade, alongside the goal of taking Sands of Time's acrobatic combat and shifting it open world. The slightest hints of a conflict with the Templars existed as well, though how much of a role they would play was unclear. The team in Montreal was more than anything motivated by the promise of a new generation of hardware that allowed for a massive expansion in scope. No longer would it just be the Palace of Azad, with concept art showing off a balance between wide-open desert locales and bustling city markets. It was, however, unclear what that hardware would be at that point, as it was still a full year before the announcement of the Xbox 360. There was a lot of guesswork, and more than anything, a lot of upfront pre-production that was beginning to pull the project in a completely new direction. In mid-2004, animator Alex Druin would create a pre-rendered proof of concept for the project under the working title Prince of Persia: Assassins, which was designed to show Ubisoft higher-ups where the team's heads were at. Even in this early state, the shift away from Prince of Persia and the unique vision that would define Assassin's Creed is here. Templars are assassinated, walls are climbed, and chases through busy marketplaces were had. Its fluidity of motion was startling and felt like the key for the whole project being successful. One designer, Richard Dumas, would take it upon himself to head up the free-running mechanic. Having been the lead on the Sands of Time's platforming, it felt like a welcome challenge. With that freedom of movement and a world that was designed to feel grounded and crowded, early designers wanted to capture the things that they were unable to do on Sands of Time, taking influence from games like Grand Theft Auto, but with more open expression from the player.
I wanted to replace the car in GTA with a third-person action character. The pleasure of driving a car in Liberty City should be the same as the main character in Assassin's Creed.
The market trend was moving away from the relatively linear experience of the last Prince of Persia games, and at the same time, the project's scope was rapidly leaving the prince himself behind as well. With the very early switch away from the prince as the player character, pinpointing the exact moment Prince of Persia Assassins became Assassin's Creed is a little tricky. Initially, it was clear that Ubisoft higher-ups didn't quite understand what the team was doing. When that fake gameplay footage was shown, Desolée's team went out of their way to avoid referencing the prince altogether, and really hitting the assassin fantasy as the core of the pitch. But being a new console, new engine, and new gameplay style, sacrificing the brand recognition of Prince of Persia was a tricky sell. It was, at that time, a very big franchise. Even to a more casual observer, the gameplay looked very much like what Prince of Persia could be on next-generation hardware, with its focus on wall running and sword fighting. As a result, Ubisoft was insisting that, despite everything, this would be a game featuring a monarch in the Middle East. Internally, the project would keep either the Assassin subtitle or simply be referred to as Prince of Persia Next Gen until mid-2006, only a year before its projected release in Q4 2007. Desolée himself would be approached by Ubisoft marketing at GDC 2 months before its announcement at E3 and pitch the name Assassin's Creed, in reference to the phrase sometimes translated as "everything is true, nothing is permitted" from the 1938 novel Al-Amut, which told the story of Hassani Sabah and the Assassins as an allegory for the rise of fascism at that time. It's a good name, one that fits the more philosophical approach of the finished product, while again feeling inspired by pulp conspiracy novels of the era. And the reference to the "everything is permitted" part of the creed felt in line with the free, non-linear, less mission-focused gameplay they were shooting for. It is worth pointing out, however, that very little beyond the name changed when Assassin's Creed fully left the Prince of Persia franchise. And with a release targeted for the following year in 2007, the team would absorb devs from the other Prince of Persia products at Ubisoft, exploding the team from about 20 to over 100. Multiple members of the team after the fact discuss how glad they were to be working on a new IP, and that building something mostly from scratch was rare at Ubisoft, who at that time was mostly releasing Tom Clancy games or tie-ins to bigger franchises. Assassin's Creed was a blue sky, and while it was a challenge, it gave the team the opportunity to create something new and be motivated by a potential future of the series. As producer Jade Raymond put it,
"If we do create a game that's successful, how do we make sure there's an overarching meta story that can continue to play out? That's why we created the Animus."
At its core, the Animus, the Matrix-inspired VR simulation used as a framing device, also gave an opportunity for new parts of history, and for Assassin's Creed to be a series that maintained a core cast of characters while still keeping the aesthetics and story fresh. It feels somewhat inspired by the Sands of Time's own bedtime story framing device with a next-gen twist, replacing the moments of "no, that's not right" with a desynchronization from events that actually happened. It's something that Ubisoft itself was skeptical of, basically forbidding developers from bringing it up during previews, leading to awkward moments of journalists asking, "so why is that guard glowing?" Desolée, Raymond, and team, however, were insistent that this wasn't a historical game. Instead, it was a science fiction game that just so happened to take place in the past. Assassin's Creed would release in November of 2007 to positive reviews, praising its open gameplay design and unique concept, while criticizing its samey mission structure and side quest design that were obviously late additions. The game was considered to be very good, and in comparison to later entries, very weird, making for a great foundation whose jagged edges would be filed off and its more non-traditional structuring put in line with the mission design of something like Grand Theft Auto almost immediately with its sequels. While the series today is synonymous with the overbloated sameness Ubisoft is known for, AC1 is that next-generation open-world Prince of Persia that was promised, which made for some problems when a new Prince of Persia reboot would be released next year. Prince of Persia 2008 started development around the release of The Two Thrones, adopting a new, more colorful art style and taking the prince away from the throne and turning him into a wandering adventurer with a new companion. It was a big departure for the series, and was something more clearly inspired by independent and artsy linear platformers of the time. While it had a lot of what made the series great, it still alienated a lot of fans of Ubisoft's original trilogy, removing the challenge and the stakes by not allowing the player to die and reworking the combat into one-on-one duels with larger creatures. With the success of Assassin's Creed a year prior and its sequel a year after, Prince of Persia 2008 may not have been intentionally designed to reevaluate what a new current-gen entry in the series could be in its successor's wake, but it certainly feels that way. And with the series returning to a more traditional experience and aesthetic in the Forgotten Sands in 2010, it made Ubisoft look confused as to what Prince of Persia was in the modern era. Even again, if Forgotten Sands was never intended as an apology for 2008's departure, it was hard to separate it from that feeling. That, coupled with the growing success of the now yearly Assassin's Creed franchise, an unsuccessful film from Disney, and continued licensing fees to original Prince of Persia creator Jordan Mechner, it was beginning to feel like Prince of Persia was on borrowed time. His final death blow from the Assassins would come in the form of Prince of Persia Redemption, a canceled prototype shown off to Ubisoft higher-ups in the hopes of once again rebooting the series. While the pre-rendered footage was similar to the proof of concept for Prince of Persia Assassins, Redemption would fail to make it out of the pitch stage entirely. Animator Jonathan Cooper would speculate that it had something to do with the aforementioned licensing fees to Jordan Mechner, while confirming that the recently unearthed footage had been created by another animator, Kai Nguyen, who would go on to be animation director on 2017's For Honor. For Assassin's Creed, however, Redemption would provide the inspiration for its reworked free-running with more scripted encounters in Assassin's Creed 3. This is probably felt most in its Pegleg missions, which came as a continuation of Assassin's Creed 2 and Brotherhood's Tomb and Romulus side quests, which featured linear Prince of Persia-style environments. From Redemption came a crumbling, chaotic-feeling layer to these, making them feel like puzzles that were being solved while the world was shifting around you. They were mostly spectacle, blending the line between cutscene and gameplay, and feel more in line with something like Uncharted as much as Prince of Persia. But the influence from the Redemption demo is clear. Until the announcement of Lost Crown in 2023, the Prince of Persia series would largely go quiet, getting only an announcement and likely cancellation of a ground-up remake of Sands of Time that featured graphics that weren't up to modern standards by any stretch. Assassin's Creed, on the other hand, would continue to grow outward, becoming one of Ubisoft's core franchises and creating some of the Xbox 360 generation's strongest titles in the Ezio trilogy, and some of the next generation's more controversial in the likes of Unity. As the series moved forward, its iterative design and larger maps have been the subject of criticism. While these games would continue to be great journeys into historic worlds, their average finish times would go from around 20 hours to closer to 40 and 50. And the original Animus plot would become non-existent at best and incomprehensible at worst. It's a long way from its roots as a next-gen Prince of Persia game, and it's hard to not miss the constant reinvention, the reboots, and the wide range of art styles. It's a kill-your-darlings approach that leads to both hits and misses, and while its biggest misses are often disappointments, its biggest hits can lead to one of the biggest franchises in gaming to this day. Thank you.